Lichens. Lichen is a symbiotic association between a fungi and algae. In this symbiotic relation, the fungi provides the food, the nutrient and the water, and algal partner provides food. Also, the fungal partner protects the algal partner from excess desiccation. And in any lichen where the algal partner is missing, then the fungal partner also dies away. In this video, I'll be discussing various aspects about lichen. But in the coming videos, I will be discussing very detailed about the economically important lichens, the endangered lichens, the reproductive organs of lichens, and the various type of lichens according to structure and function. Hello friends, I am Mayantika, and in this video, I'll be discussing a general overview about lichens. Now, as we know that lichens contains of a phycobiont partner, that is the photosynthetic partner algae, and the microbiont partner, that is the fungus. Among the microbiont partner, mostly lichens contain ascomycete and very rarely basidiomycete. And among algal partner, it contains both green and blue-green algae. Now, in earlier times, it was thought that fungus and green algae were the only two partners in this mutualistic, commensalistic partnership. But later, by the genomic sequencing of the RNA, it was found that also blue-green algae, that is the cyanobacteria, is also present sometimes in this association. This is a mutualistic association, or we can say commensalism, where both the partners are getting benefited from each other. When the fungi and algae, they are in this type of association, this association is also called lichenization. Among the fungal species, mostly the ascomycetes are present in the lichen form, and among algal species, the green algae, we mostly find Triboxia, Trentophylla, Myrmica. And among cyanobacterial partner, we find Nostoc, Cytonema, Rivularia. Now, this lichen can be of different color depending upon the type of pigment. Say, for example, certain lichen can have yellow color, for example cladonia. Also, depending upon the type of structure, lichen can be divided into fructicotes, folios, crustos, filamentous, lepros, gelatinous, and squamineus. The habitat of lichen. Lichen can grow in temperate as well as the rainforest, but the main criteria should be that the air should be humid and the amount of sunlight should be low. Now, you must be guessing, you must be wondering that how in rainforest area, where it is in the tropical region, this lichens are there. In the rainforest area, mostly we find multiple layers of tree. So, the ground vegetation rarely gets light. So, these lichens are mostly found in the riverine region or in the bark or any other wood material that has fallen down. It can grow on the rock also in this type of rainforest, where only the top canopy gets the maximum maximum amount of sunlight. So these lichens mainly grow in the bark or the lower surface, lower canopy trees, and in temperate region they are found even in the very high trees as well as other type of habitat. Now, one of the main feature which helps lichen to be so resilient is that it is polyhydric, which means that it can live on very little amount of water. I mean, this lichen, once it is hydrated, it starts photosynthesizing. But if it is suffers from desiccation, then it stops its metabolism but does not die. It can again start resynthesizing and metabolizing after it gets the water. Cryptobiosis, which means that lichens can grow in various type of temperatures. Mostly, the vast majority of lichens, they are mainly terrestrial, and they can grow on the wet soil, they can grow on the rock, and they can grow on the bark, which is corticoloous. They can grow on any other woody material, which is lichenocolous lichen, lignicolous lichen. But there are also some type of lichens which can grow in water. Among water, aquatic lichens, most of the lichens are freshwater, and this lichen, they are mostly found in the freshwater where it usually suffers from desiccation for a majority period of time. I mean, it can grow in the surrounding area, the of the in the lake shores or the riverine region, where it gets submerged for some period of time and it remains above water during the rest period of the time. So this poikilohydry helps the lichen to survive in this type of environment. Also, due to the cryptobiotic, it can present it can be present in both the cold temperate region as well as the very hot tropical rainforests. These lichens, they are the pioneer species in any ecosystem. They by forming they grow on the crevices of the rock, and they degrade the rock both physically as well as chemically. They actually they absorb the various materials, metals falling on them. They accumulate metals, and these metals react with the acids produced by the lichen and form or complex organic organic metallic complexes with the rock material. By this way, the lichen chemically weather the rock on which it is growing. And physically also, the lichen can penetrate the rock crevices with the help of its rhizoid, and due to rapid heating and cooling in the tropical region and the temperate region where the water gets inside the rock crevices, and when the temperature lowers, it actually water freezes and expands. So in this way, it produces cracks in the rock. In the tropical region also, cooling and heating of the rock also produces cracks, and these cracks are gradually filled up by expanding rhizoid thallus of the lichen. So lichen chemically and physically degrades the rocky material and converts the area into very secondary clay material, and also its dead lichen provide organic substratum on which other species can also grow. Thus, this acts as a very pioneer species in any ecosystem. The primary structure of lichen. Now, if we see the structure of lichen, we can see that lichen are two types. One is the homomeric, another is the heteromeric. In homomeric, lichen there is no differentiation of the lichen into different layers. Means that there will be a uniform single layer where the algal cells are entangled in the hyphal mass. But here in the picture we see the heteromerous lichen, which is the more complex form of lichen where the structure is divided into various strata. The very upper layer, which is the upper cortex, it has very tightly packed hyphal filaments, and this acts as a protective layer. Next to it, underneath the upper cortex, is the algal zone or the photobiotic zone, where the algal cells are present intermingled with the hypha of the fungi, and this layer is the only photosynthetic region. Next to it, underneath the algal zone, is the medullary zone. This medulla has also entangled fungal hyphae, but the entanglement or enmeshment is a bit looser than the upper cortex. Below it is the lower cortex, and in this lower cortex we see that the hypha, they are entangled tightly than the medulla, but less tightly than the upper cortex. And beyond the lower cortex is the rhizines, which are unicellular or multicellular. They are generally simple, but sometimes branch rhizines can be also be found. Now, this lower cortex is absent in some type of fungi, so some type of lichens. For example, it can be the lower cortex is generally absent in the squamulose, in gelatinous, leprous, and bisoid lichens. Now, squamulose lichens are scale-like lichens which have a very raised margin, which is mottled with different shades, and the gelatinous lichen. This is it produces mucilaginous material or extracellular to the lichen. And the leprous lichen is actually very powdery type of lichen. And bisoid lichen is it looks like a very woolly type of lichen. So in this four type of lichen, that is the squamulose, gelatinous, leprous, and bisoid lichen, the lower cortex is not present. The primary thallus of the lichen, which I have discussed in the previous slide, also contain other structures like cephalodium and the breathing spore. This cephalodium, it is a mixture of algal cell intermingled with fungal hyphae and has a very dense upper cortex of intermeshed fungal hyphae. So this cephalodium, which contains both algal and fungal partner, it when matures, it is blown away by the wind, or it detaches and is taken to different transported by water to a different place, where if the the substratum of the new place is conductive for growth, then this cephalodium grows into a new lichen colony. And in the left picture, in the right picture, we see the breathing pore, which is present on the lower surface of the lichen. This breathing pore is for the aeration, so that the algae can get some amount of carbon dioxide from here for its photosynthesis. This primary thallus, it grows horizontally to the horizontal and parallel to the surface of leaf. Apart from this, the lichen also contain secondary type of structures. The secondary thallus of a lichen sometimes contain vertical thallus. The lichen generally contain of two type, mainly the primary thallus and sometimes secondary thallus. Now the secondary thallus is a vertical structure, so it is mostly found in dimorphic lichens, but this secondary thallus is a way of occasional, and it contains either the apothecia or soradia, or sometimes the secondary thallus does not contain these structures also. It is mostly found in many species of Cladonia and one species of Cladia. The secondary thallus has a way, it rises from the primary thallus and has the cortex in the base of the horizontal structure. And this horizontal structure is a very hollow, has a hollow inside. And in the lining of it has algal layer and fungal layer. But it does not have cortex in the whole of the podacea. This podacea has only the cortex in its base. In the upper part of the upper globulous part of the podacea, mostly the apothecia are found, and which are variously colored. The vegetative reproductive structure. Now the lichen, it grows by either the vegetative or sexual method. Among the vegetative method, we see that we have soradia and isidia. Now this soradia, it is a mixture of algal and hyphal cell. So is also isidium, but the main difference between them is that they are physically different. The soradia, it is globulose, and the isidium, it is very cylindrical, either branched or unbranched. But the, in spite of their physical difference, their physiological, physiologically, they are very similar. These are the sexually reproductive structures, perithecium and apothecium. This perithecium is flask shaped and mostly found in the basidiomycetes, and apothecium is found in the mostly in the ascomycetes. And these are all male reproductive structures of the lichen. In both perithecium and apothecium, we see that there is an intermixture of fertile and infertile hypha. The fertile hypha in the perithecium contains polyspores, and in the apothecium it is the ascospores, and it is intermingled with infertile or sterile structures by the name of paraphysis and periphysis. In perithecium, the opening is the pear-shaped perithecium has an opening called osteole, and the cup-shaped apothecium does not need much opening as it is a cup-shaped. And on maturity of the ascospores, on maturity of these ascospores or porispores, they burst, and these ascospores are released in the ear, which reaches the female carpogonium, that will be shown in the next slide. The lichen, the female sexual reproductive organ of this lichen is the is shown in the picture. Here we see that the upper portion is the trichogyne and the lower portion is the coil structure. In the male reproductive organ, the spores are released, which after blown away by the wind or water, reaches the trichogyne. And on reaching the trichogyne, the wall between the spore and the trichogyne, it diffuses, and the content of the spore, it passes to the coiled portion by dissolution of the cell wall of the upper portion of the carpogony. And after reaching the coiled portion, it is fertilized. I'll be discussing about the reproductive structure in detail in my upcoming videos. So we'll get a detailed account about the vegetative and sexual reproduction of lichens. This is just an overview. According to the type of structure, lichens can be divided into foliose lichen, fructicose lichen, bisoid, crustose, squamulose, gelatinous, lepros, and filamentous. Now, this fructicose lichen. Fructicose lichen is the vegetative body is very tiny. It tastes leaf-like, but if it branches profusely, this fructicose lichen may sometimes look like the foliose lichen. But this fructicose lichen is a micro lichen, and foliose, which looks like the leaf or leaf-like structure, and the lobes are the branches are leaf-like, but this folios is a macro lichen. So bisoid lichen, it is a filamentous. It looks like wool. And the crustose lichen or placodioid lichen, it grows very close to the surface, and so it grows so close to the surface of the rock that we cannot obtain the placoid lichen in its entire form. It while dislodging it from the rock, it will get either torn or broken. So it grows very closely adhered to the surface. And the squamulose lichen, it looks like the scales where the vegetative body the thallus, margin of the thallus is raised, and it has certain spots. It looks like the scales of a fish. Gelatinous lichen, these are filamentous or any type of lichens, may mostly secrete mucilaginous substance. This main idea behind this secretion is to protect the lichen from desiccation. Lepros lichen, it is appears very powdery, and it mostly grows on the tree or branches. Filamentous lichen, it looks like a very matted hair. It looks also woolly. Now, lichenology. Lichenology is a study of lichen. Now, there are many importance for the study of lichens, because once it has got a very a wide range of economic and ecological importance. So, lichens are usually studied for their ecologic economic benefit. Also, it is used for dating of rocks on which surface it is found. That study is called lichenometry. Now, these are the names of various herbariums where lichens can be found. Now, this lichens, for preparing the lichen herbarium, we should either store them in paper envelopes, or if it is like crustose lichen, which cannot be detached from the rock in intact form, they are actually kept in the herbarium along with the rock on which it grows. So that type of herbarium, that type of specimen is usually collected, wrapped with tissue paper and kept. all these lichen herbariums, they should be kept in very cold temperature, dust free atmosphere, and away from sunlight, and also dry atmosphere. These are the name of fossil lichens which are found. We see very few type, a few very few species of lichens are present in the fossil form. It doesn't mean that these type of the lichens are were absent in the ancient time, but it only means that just because the lichens which contains algae and fungi, both of which does not have hard thickened cell wall, they do not have lignified cell wall, so they are not so well preserved. Most of the lichens, they are in the form of impression. That is why we find very few number of fossil lichens. Winfrentia, which is found in Scotland, is a Devonian period lichen, and the Spongiophyton is also in the Devonian, and Nematothallus and Prototaxites is found during the Silurian Devonian, and Lobaria lichen is found in the Miocene, and Glomeromycota is found during the Precambrian period. With this, I come to the end of the video. There will be more videos about importances of lichen. And the reproduction of lichens, the different type of lichens based on structure and based on the type of substratum in which it grows, and various endangered and rare species of lichen in detail. So please subscribe the channel to get updates about this type of videos regarding the lichens. Thank you for watching. Please like, share and subscribe.